So now that we're safely anchored, we get to have fun and watch other people anchoring and see how what they do. But they're not really doing much to set the anchor. They dropped it, and that's it. And they're just the kind of the drop and pray kind of approach to anchoring. No setting of the anchor, and I don't think that they have a lot of scope out. So that would be the two things that I would be concerned about them about.
Welcome to our second video in our Anchoring 101 series from Life 4.0. Today we'll be covering some tips and tricks on setting your anchor, making sure it's fully dug in, and raising your anchor. If you haven't seen our previous video titled Preparing Your Anchor Road, you might want to watch that video first, as it has some important information and tips on how to properly mark your anchor road and setting up your snubber. Anchoring is often one of the more stressful tasks on board a boat, but it doesn't have to be that way. Once you learn a couple techniques and strategies, you'll be able to rest assured that your precious investment is there when you come back from dinner ashore or when you wake up from a long night's sleep. I will be including video shot from our Jeannot Sun Odyssey 440 named Sea Rose. And even though my examples are from a sailboat, the tips that were shown you are applicable as much to a powerboat as to a sailboat. We have multiple cameras rolling, so you're going to be able to see Karen at the helm, me up on the bow, and we also took our GoPro under the water so you can see what's going on at the seafloor level. So let's dive in. First off, let's get some terminology out of the way. And the first term is scope, and we covered this in the previous video. And as a review, scope is the relationship between the depth of the water and the amount of anchor road you have deployed. So if you're anchored in 10 feet of water and you've put out 50 feet of anchor road, then your scope is 5:1. We generally aim for a minimum of 4:1 on board Sea Rose. You're going to want to kind of figure out what works for your sailboat or powerboat, but generally we recommend a minimum of 4:1. If you're in storm conditions, you may need 6, 7, even 10:1 of scope out. The second term is road, and we also covered this in the previous video. Road is the combination of the chain and line that you attach to an anchor. So once you put the chain and line together on an anchor, that whole combination is referred to simply as road. Now that we have that squared away, let's talk about the actual setting and raising of your anchor. You're going to want a windlass to use on board your boat for this. When I first started sailing, we didn't have windlasses on boats quite as often as we do now, and lowering and raising the anchor was a huge pain. So if you don't already have a windlass on board, look at getting one because it'll help you out a lot. Now, for an electric windlass, there's two primary ways to control them. One is with foot switches that are mounted in the deck, and the other is by means of a handheld control. We prefer the handheld control. We like it a lot on Sea Rose, and it's helpful if you have to lean out over the bow to look at what's going on with the chain, or if you have somebody else helping you and one of them you can hand the control to control the windlass while maybe you're spraying down the chain to get mud off. So very helpful there. So let's assume you've got your anchor windlass all ready to go and your anchor road is all properly marked. You're all set to start. So let's go on board Sea Rose for the process.
Okay, so we're getting ready to anchor here. I've got the anchor locker open and the snubber wrapped around the cleat and ready to go. This safety line I've taken off, and I'm gonna take out the handle and just lay it over the rail there as a good starting point.
He's just putting out the requisite amount of chain right now. We always do a 4:1 ratio. In good weather and more in inclement or unknown weather or in tough seas. And that's a 4:1 ratio with the depth. So what I'm seeing is a depth of 7 meters in, and that's below our keel. So then we add 2 meters for the keel and then about a meter to get up to the top of where the chain is coming out off the front of our bowsprit. So then that would be 7, 8, 9, 10. So then he's probably putting out about 40 meters.
You'll notice that the boat is completely stopped in the water as the anchor goes down. You don't want any movement. As you let more chain out, the boat is going to slowly drift downwind, and this is okay.
but keep the speed slow, otherwise the anchor will skip along the bottom and not dig in.
So I got four red marks there, one mark for each 10 meters, that's 40 meters out. Definitely if it was more stormy or higher wind chance, we would go more towards a 6-1 or 8-1, but 4-1 is generally a good starting point. So I'm waiting for the anchor chain to line up with the bow and the stern, and then Karen can go in reverse, and we'll start to set it. So she'll go slow at first and then accelerate. So chain straight now.
So he's letting me know that the chain is straight, so I'll put it in reverse and try to tighten slowly, not a hard reverse, but I'll try to tighten slowly the chain. Once the chain gets tight, then the anchor can be pulled into the sand. So I'm in a slow reverse right now. Once he says that it's extremely tight, then I'll keep throttling up until usually about 200 RPMs. And we feel that that is a good way to make sure to really set the anchor down into the ground.
And I'm putting my toe on the chain. I'm trying to be careful, but I can feel what the anchor's doing with a little bit of touch, either with a toe or a hand. And understand if the chain, the anchor is dragging or what. The chain's going to extend out. Usually when we drop like this, a whole bunch of chain kind of falls in one place. There's a pile of it. And you'll hear this sort of like rubbing sound and kind of clinking sound. It's not really the anchor dragging necessarily. It sort of sounds like feels like the anchor's going over rock. But it's just the chain pile kind of loosening up and stretching out. So there's a little clump there. It might be piled over top itself. It's sort of extending out, so you can expect this to take a little bit of reverse for that to really extend out. It's just starting to get a little tight. So she wants to know if it's getting tight. Once it gets tight, she can add more RPMs. But you don't want to rev it up too quick, otherwise you'll just jerk the anchor right out of where it was going to set.
Is it very tight? Okay. Course looking behind me. Now this is the closest we'll be to this boat behind us because I'm pulling on my anchor right now, you know, straightening my chain all the way out, but as soon as I take it out of reverse, the chain will, you know, slacken some and it'll pull us a little bit further away from them. But it gives you an idea of, you know, worst case scenario, this is the closest that we should be. Now what you do to make sure that you're set is you take a point in the foreground and a point on the distance, and you look at it and you compare them, and if you see them staying the same, right in line and not changing, then you're holding. And right now what I'm seeing, I usually watch it for a while, and I'm seeing pretty good holding. I'm gonna rev up a little bit, and now I'm at 2000 RPMs, and that's usually where, you know, I don't usually go much beyond that. I'll look again here. I think we're really pretty good. And then Tom's doing the same thing on the fore deck. So we'll get a confirmation with each other that we both think that we're holding.
Point, we're trying to look to see how we're holding. I'm lining up a point in the foreground with a point in the distance. The best situation is a sailboat mast between you and the shore. I don't have that. I got the sailboat over here, but I've got a little island in the foreground. Well, those umbrellas over there. I got an island in the foreground, the umbrellas in the distance. So I'm looking at that, and I'm trying to see if they change position. If they hold relative to each other, then we know that we're holding. So now I can feel little clunks here. Like the chain may still be extending out, but it's getting pretty stiff and relatively straight there. You can see all the wash from the reversing of the propeller. So I'm still looking with those umbrellas in the distance with the island in the foreground. They're moving a little bit, but not too much. This last part, as she revs up, the boat will typically move just a little bit more. Yeah, I can hear her revving up now, so it may move another 8 or 10 feet. Yeah, I still see a little bit of movement, and I hear a clank, and I feel it on my toe. So that's usually the anchor, you know, again, the last little bit of chain extending out, and then the flukes of the anchor starting to dig in if everything's going right. So still very similar position with those umbrellas and the island in the foreground. Don't really see much. We're gonna wait here. Yeah, it looks good. So we're good there. Boat's holding.
It looks to me like we're holding. Okay. All right, so I can lock down the wheel now. We always lock down the wheel so that as we're hit with waves from boats, the rudders aren't slapping back and forth. And it gives you the best opportunity to stay straight in the wind. Right now he's putting on the snubber, and then he'll put the snubber out. He's tightening, he ties a rope on there, he'll show you that. He'll put the snubber out, and then the engine can be turned off.
Last step then is to put the snubber on. So I'm gonna use a rolling hitch. And the way I do a rolling hitch, some people have different opinions about this, but I wrap around twice on sort of the boat side, not the stern side, not the bow. And then I cross over, and I just put a half hitch right there. All right, and then I tighten that up really well. If you don't tighten it up, it can slip on the chain. This may not seem like it's gonna hold on the chain, but we've had huge blows, 50, 60 knots of wind, and this knot there holds really well. Rolling hitch is very valuable for a lot of purposes on a boat. We use it a lot for snubbers. So now I got the snubber attached. I'm gonna let more chain out so that the snubber's taking the load instead of the windlass. And I'm adding a lot of extra chain. You can see the chain kind of hanging down there quite a bit below the knot. The purpose of that is just to make sure that the snubber's really taking the load. Sometimes the snubber will stretch out a little bit, so you want to have extra chain there to account for that, and so there's no chance that the chain will get loaded up and therefore the windlass. The whole purpose of the snubber is to take the load off the windlass. You don't want continuous pull and jerking and all that stress to the windlass. It can take, like when we were setting the anchor, it can take the strain of that. It can take the strain when you're pulling the anchor up. But, you know, for 12 hours overnight, you don't want to have the strain on the windlass. The other valuable part about a snubber is that it has a little bit of stretch to it. This is a dock line, nylon dock line, so it has a little bit of stretch. And so it can kind of give a little bit of a absorbing effect if there's a surge or waves and all that. So you don't need too much. This goes right about to the waterline. That's enough. You could put more on if you want, but then this is more line to have to worry about. And I've got this chafe gear on here to protect. It was starting to rub. The chain was starting to rub. If the snubber was under or different position than the chain, it was starting to rub the snubber. So I put this chain guard on here attached with zip ties. So that's the arrangement. We're all done with that. Close up the locker. Just double check that everything's okay. And we're all anchored. So the very last step in anchoring is to go swim on the anchor to make sure that it's set, that it's pulled down into the sand or seafloor and it's holding really well. So that's what I'm gonna do now. Jump in the water and snorkel over and check it out. We're lucky today because the water is super warm and it's also quite clear, so it should make this job easy.
You'll start to see the anchor in the middle of the frame with only the top fluke showing. The other two flukes are dug in nice and deep. The shank, which would normally be to the right of the fluke, is completely buried. If you look to the left of the anchor, you see a 1 meter long disturbance in the sand. This is the short distance it took for it to dig in, which is an excellent indicator of the performance of the anchor. Even the first 2 meters of the chain are buried, which was another good sign of a good set.
In some situations when we're in a tight anchorage and I'm just kind of concerned about how many boats there are, especially if they're close to us, I'll go ahead and swim on other people's anchors as well, just to check to see how well it's set, what kind of anchor it is, how much scope they have out, and just to get a comfort factor. And, you know, that way you know what you're faced with and whether, if they're nice, maybe you can convince them to re-anchor or to let more scope out. Other times you just know that, well, maybe you should just move and find a better spot rather than having to deal with people's egos and emotions. But it's a handy thing, especially boats that are upwind of you, to get an idea of how they're set, what kind of anchor they have, and if they have enough scope out.
Okay, so let's review. Regarding scope, you want to make sure you have a minimum of 4:1. By the way, if you're in a tidal area, you want to determine your scope based on the depth at high tide, or the worst case scenario. You want to attach your snubber to a cleat so it's ready to go. You want to lower your chain down and make sure the boat is completely stopped in the water when you do that. Once you have all your chain out and it's straight, you want to go in slow reverse. And then you can go ahead and rev up the engine at about 2,000 RPMs. And while you're doing that, you want to be checking the range on shore. Once you're satisfied the boat is holding, then you can go ahead and turn your engine off and lock your wheel. And finally, you want to swim on your anchor. By the way, if you're in a crowded anchorage, consider using a red safety float like the one that Karen is using here. They're very helpful for being seen while you're in the water. With all that said, if there's nothing else you remember from this discussion on anchoring, make it be the importance of setting your anchor. I can't tell you how many people we see that drop their anchor, shut the engine down, and start pouring cocktails, having no idea if their anchor is dug in and will hold them. To drive the point home, I filmed the setting of our anchor while Karen released the windlass remotely from the helm. Here you will see the anchor settling down on the seafloor about 8 meters from the surface. Like it often happens, because of forward momentum of the boat, the chain starts landing upwind of the anchor and slowly curves around as the boat starts to drift downwind. You'll see here how the loop of chain forward of the anchor is wrapped around a mound of weeds and possibly rock. It takes continuous engine reverse to pull the chain through this. This is an important reality to understand. You have to back down with lots of engine RPMs to pull all that chain straight that is clustered around the anchor. Between the weight of the anchor and the 40 meters or so of chain, this weight alone can give you the impression that the anchor is dug in and holding. But we quickly realized, as we watched several times from in the water, that this is not the case. Only when you back down with 2,000 RPMs or so of engine pull will you know for sure if your anchor is dug in. I would strongly recommend, if the anchorage is quiet and you're safely away from your boat, that you put a mask on and watch your anchor as the boat is being backed down. You'll learn exactly what is needed for your anchor and boat combination to be fully dug in. Notice how the anchor is still pointed the wrong way, with its shank forward. Again, a common occurrence when there is some forward momentum when the anchor is being lowered. I'm speeding ahead here though, and after nearly 3 minutes of hard reverse, with the chain pulling on the anchor pointed in the wrong direction, finally it flips over and digs in quickly. The boat stops hard here, and we can be confident that it will hold us safely in position. Now it's time to switch the discussion to raising the anchor. Let's go back on board Sea Rose.
Okay, we're going to do a little walkthrough of raising the anchor. By the nature of it, it's a little bit easier than dropping the anchor, but you still have to keep a couple things in mind. And we've got a few swimmers in the water here as well, which will make it a little interesting. And we also have a boat right directly upwind of us, probably over top of our anchor, so we'll be working that out as well. All right, so I'm up here at the windlass, and we've got our snubber on, so I'm going to be raising the chain just enough to remove the snubber. So I've got a handheld control here for up and down, and I'm watching my hands and fingers to get them away from the windlass, because it's can do a lot of damage. So we've got a rowing hitch on here, and I'll take that off and get the snubber out of the way. And now we're going to be raising up. So the thing to watch out for when raising the anchor is to try to make sure the chain is coming directly up, so the position of the boat is over top of where the chain is rising. You don't want to use the windlass to be pulling the boat towards the anchor. You want it to be doing the least amount of work as possible. So you can see the chain is hanging pretty much straight up and down. And that's the position I want the boat in to be raising. So I'll be signaling to Karen to move the boat forward or left or right or such to try to get the chain coming directly up. And you can also see that the boat ahead of us is right, probably on top of our chain. So we'll see where this goes. Okay, forward.
So I usually just let it go forward a tiny bit, and then I take it into neutral, especially on a calm day like this. We don't have any wind against us. He just needs me to come a teeny bit forward.
So we've got super clear water here. I can see the chain going all the way down to the seafloor, and I can know exactly where to position it. Bonjour. So I'm pausing once in a while to get the chain in the right position. Neutral. The windlass was just straining there for a minute, probably pulling the anchor off the bottom. Okay, we're up off the water. So I let Karen know that we're off the water so she can navigate to where she needs to go. You don't want the boat moving too fast when you pull the anchor up just the last part out of the water, otherwise it can swing and hit the hull and put a dent in the fiberglass. Now with our anchor, it's a little different than most anchors. It's got three flukes, so I try to wait until it's in the right position so that one fluke is coming up and two flukes are going down. And then I bring it all the way up, tight.
We lucked out this time. Sometimes you actually have to work with somebody and push their boat aside a little bit in order to get underneath the anchor. But this worked out okay. So he'll secure the anchor up there and get it ready for next time. And that's it.
And I stow the snubber here. And I got a place to stow it in the locker here with a little kind of bungee cord. And then it's always ready to go there. And there's also a washdown pump here. We don't really use that too much right now, but if we were anchored in sort of muddy or sticky bottoms, we would be using the washdown to wash the hose and the chain off before it comes all the way up. You don't want any kind of mud or any kind of that kind of stuff inside your anchor locker. And the very last part is I got a little tie down here. I don't know if you can see this, a little tie down that I tied through the chain as another security measure to hold the anchor in place, and that's it.
Okay, it's time for a quick review. You want to make sure the boat's directly over the chain and making sure you're not using the windlass to pull the boat. Once you have some chain up, then you can remove the snubber. You want to wash the incoming chain as needed, and then notify the helmsperson when the anchor is up off the water, and then lash the chain with a line or a hook, and finally stow the snubber, the hose, and close up the hatch, and you're good to go. That wraps up our video on setting and raising an anchor. I hope you enjoyed it. If you did, please be sure to give it a thumbs up. That really helps us out and also helps other people find videos like this. We're going to be doing additional videos in this Anchoring 101 series. And if you are not already subscribed to our channel, please be sure to click the subscribe button and also the bell, and that will allow you to get notified of future videos when they come out. We always enjoy your comments, especially if you have anything related to this anchoring video and have other thoughts on how anchoring works for you on your boat, or any general comments. We always read them and we enjoy hearing from you. So be sure to put your comments down below in the comments section on YouTube. Thanks, and I hope you have a great day.